20 years of .NET, PWA Studio for VS Code, and a ridiculously indulgent example of WebAssembly. All that and more this week on The Download. Welcome back to another episode of The Download. I'm your host, Christina Warren, Senior Cloud Advocate. And I decided to go back to one of my favorites this week, which means I'm repping some Taylor Swift merch. Oh, and did you know that there is now a Taylor Swift-themed Wordle clone? It's very cool. And speaking of Wordle, quick update on that. It's been acquired. That's right, forget about Microsoft buying Activision Blizzard or even Sony buying Bungie. The big news is that the New York Times has acquired Wordle. What a world, or what a word, I guess. I don't know. Anyway, congrats to Josh Wardell. Okay, enough of all that, let's do this thing. First up, I wanna talk about the big news that is both very amazing, but it also makes me feel ridiculously old, and that's that .NET is turning 20. That's right, 20 years ago this month, .NET was introduced to the world. So, on February 14th at 9 a.m. Pacific, the .NET team is gonna be throwing a huge celebration. It's basically a 30-minute event, and it's gonna feature interviews with luminaries and Microsoft alumni, stories from customers and developers who are building amazing things, memories of building .NET with Scott Hunter and everyone's favorite developer, Scott Hanselman, as well as special guests and much, much more from open source contributors, MVPs, .NET team members. Go over to .net.microsoft.com for more information. And additionally, the .NET team has actually put some really great swag on GitHub, including desktop and Teams backgrounds. There's even like some files if you want to get a sheet cake made, which is apparently a thing, okay. Also, if you wanna start diving into the history of .NET, I wanna give the .NET Rocks podcast a shout out. My pal Richard Campbell and his amazing host Carl Franklin talk .NET every week, but this week they talk with one of my favorite people on the planet, Miguel De Queza, about his experiences with .NET over the years. Miguel actually created Mono, which was the first open source implementation of .NET back in the day. Anyway, it's a great listen. So I've got links in the show notes and the description for details on all the .NET 20th anniversary festivities, the GitHub repo, and Richard's podcast. Good stuff. Speaking of really fun events, on February 15th, which is like the day after the .NET event, is Azure Open Source Day. And this is gonna be a really cool event that I encourage anyone who's interested in the OSS side of Azure to check out. So it definitely includes me. So this event, you'll learn about how Microsoft is committed to open source and how they work with the open source community to develop new technologies. And you'll also hear about some of the latest trends and capabilities using Linux and Azure together, direct from Microsoft insiders. And it's also going to be feature really great people like Sarah Novotny and Brendan Burns, and it's going to include details on CBL Mariner, which is a Linux distribution built by Microsoft to host Azure open source services. Very cool stuff. So I've got links for the event in the show notes and the description down below. Be sure to check it out. All right, next up, this is some breaking news that I literally like had to write right before I got ready to record this show. So the latest version of Visual Studio Code is out. So this is Visual Studio Code 1.64. It's the January 2022 release, and it's the first release of the year, and it's a big one. So some of the new highlights include a new side panel, so you can display more views at once with the side panel. There's also a settings editor search. There are now audio cues. There's a Unicode highlighting, which is cool, so you can avoid like highlighting characters in supported languages. There are some improvements to the notebook UI, so you can now search text in Markdown and in output cells. There's the ability to debug binary data. There are Markdown path suggestions. There are some JavaScript and TypeScript snippet features. And VS Code for the web is now supported for signed GitHub commits at both vscode.dev and github.dev. Anyway, there's a lot of great stuff. The new side panel looks really slick. You can check all that out in details on what's new in the show notes and the description down below. And you can also download the latest version of VS Code there too. So moving right along, speaking of updates, Power Toys, one of our favorite apps, got another update, and it also brought some brand new features in addition to bug fixes. So first, there's a new mouse utility that was co-developed with the accessibility team at Microsoft, and there's also a new File Explorer add-on for the preview pane, and it's from Aaron Junker, a member of our community, and it supports previewing like 150 different developer file types in the File Explorer preview pane using the Monaco editor. It's really cool stuff. Check out the release notes and the download links in the show notes and the description down below. in a return to a segment that I used to call Bruno's Java Corner. I wanted to give a shout out to the OpenJDK team for adding two new additions to the Microsoft build of OpenJDK, a family of long-term support binaries. We've got OpenJDK 11 and OpenJDK 17 for Alpine Linux, and OpenJDK 11 for macOS using Apple Silicon. I love it. Details are in the show notes and the description. Speaking of stuff that I love, a huge shout out to the PWA builder team, that is the Progressive Web App Builder team, who's just released a brand new VS Code extension called PWA Studio that allows you to build your progressive web apps in just a couple of clicks in VS Code. And it also offers tips, debugging, and it'll even help you package your PWA for distribution on Android or iOS. You can even submit it to the Microsoft Store, and you can even launch it directly to an Azure Static Web App. Plus, the extension is on GitHub, and the team would love your feedback. This is great. Kudos to this team. It's excellent. All right. Now, speaking about Azure Static Web Apps, let's talk about a great blog post from John Riley on how you can use Bicep and GitHub Actions to deploy a static website directly to Azure Static Web Apps. And even better, John shows you how you can migrate an existing static solution, like GitHub Pages, to Azure Static Web Apps. This actually came at a perfect time for me because I've been wanting to migrate a couple of things that I have on GitHub Pages to Azure Static Web Apps, and the post goes through all the steps. It's also a great primer if you're new to the whole Azure Static Web Apps thing. So great work, John. Links are in the show notes and the description down below. Now, speaking of GitHub, we've got a ton of GitHub news to plow through, so let's kind of get into it. So first, GitHub announced some updates to its GitHub Sponsors program, and GitHub Sponsors is a really great way to support the open source community or to get support for the projects that you contribute back to the community as a whole. So some of the biggest new additions are the ability for developers and organizations who have GitHub Sponsors to be able to attach a private repository to each of their sponsorship tiers. And so this will grant respective funders access to that repository. I'm going to go ahead and make the same joke that everyone on Twitter was making. Yes, it's like OnlyFans, but for open source. Honestly, I really actually think this is great for both devs and organizations because you can do release previews, you could have, you know, more closed group discussions. It's great. You can also now set minimum amounts of sponsorships, and GitHub Sponsors will now calculate sales tax and VAT. There are a lot more details about what's coming up in a blog post, which I've linked in the show notes and the description down below. But if you're not a GitHub contributor to sponsor projects, do it. It feels good. In more GitHub news, the NPM team announced they are rolling out mandatory 2FA on all maintainers for the top 100 NPM projects. And so this is going to go a long way to make sure that NPM is more secure than ever. And in the future, this is actually going to expand even more than the top 100 projects. And so I've got more information about that in the links and description down below. And finally, shout out to Brian Douglas over at GitHub for his great guide on how you can set up a CI/CD pipeline using GitHub Actions in 4 easy steps. Brian's guide is really thorough and it includes some videos. I really like it. So links again for all of this stuff is in the show notes and the description. And now it's time for my pick of the week. So sometimes I see something so audacious, so ridiculous, it just makes me smile. And this is one of those times. So the folks over at Leaning Technologies did something pretty slick with WebAssembly. They made a serverless virtual Linux environment that runs unmodified Debian binaries in the browser. It's so cool. It's powered by ChirpX, which is a WebAssembly virtualization platform that they've created. You can check out the demo over at webvm.io. And this is a little utility, but this is kind of like, you know, George Mallory said, you know, they asked him, why are you trying to climb Mount Everest? And he said, because it's there. Why would you create this? Because you can. I love the audacity of this stuff, plus it works. So you can check out the blog post in the show notes to see how it was built. And you can also have some fun playing around with it yourself. You can do what I did, which was break my machine by trying to install Node in the Wasm Web VM. So that does it for me this week. Let me know the most ridiculous things you've seen on the internet in the show notes and the description down below. And if you also leave a comment on any of the other stories that we had. If you like this episode, go ahead and give us a thumbs up on YouTube. It really does help us out. And go ahead and subscribe to Microsoft Developer for all your nerd needs. See you next time.